Okay, so we are, I want to say we have just started, but we've been on it for a while, on our 12-step study, walking the 12 steps with Jesus Christ, a spiritual journey. But we have just started because we're still on step one. All right, I was looking, I think it's been about 2 months, just about 2 months, and we're still hammering on step one. We're still on step one tonight, and I was like, man. But, you know, I was sitting there thinking, see a lot of people and see a lot of things, and so many people, so many times myself, have not grasped all the things of step one. So many times we want to move on. We want to move on to the meat. Let's move on to the meat of things. And never get the foundation. Never get the foundation of things. We like to run from, we'll go from here and start feeling a little something. And the first time we start feeling something, have a little aha moment or a little God moment, some goosebumps, we skip everything in between. We skip the bottom half and we go straight down here to a spiritual experience, and the next thing you know, we're down in step 12, giving back, and we don't even know what happened. And that never ends well. That never ends well for the individual or anybody around the individual. So we want to make sure that we're taking our time. We're in no hurry. I have no idea how long we'll be on this. It can be a year. It can be 2 years. When the Lord says move to the next, we'll move to the next. Until then, we're going to keep unpacking. If y'all are okay with that. Everybody all right with that?
Yes.
Amen. All right. So, still on step one. We're still admitting. We've admitted we're powerless over the effects of our separation from God. The 12 steps in AA says that we admitted that we were powerless over alcohol. So we've come to the conclusion now that we realize the spiritual side of this, and we realize that it's truly the effects of the separation from God. So we're still looking. We're coming to the conclusion that yes, we are powerless. We have got to a point that some of our compulsive behavior and things have just been out of control, whether it's my just personal life or my surroundings, or things are just chaos, dysfunction. Anybody ever been there or seem to attract it? You ever seen like, oh man, this stuff just follows me around. Why are things out of control? Why are things unmanageable? What is wrong with everybody? You know, what's wrong with everybody else? You know, people need to get it together, right? Well, no, we're starting to see that we see that it's us. We're starting to own it. We're starting to get ready. You know, the pain's got to the point, it's got unmanageable to the point that we can't even stand it anymore. We want change. We're ready for change. We're ready to do what it takes. I'm standing in front of the mirror. I found the problem. I see the problem very clearly. I'm standing in front of the mirror, and the problem is me. That can be a hard pill to swallow sometimes, but it can be the pill that changes your life, if we can say that. I see that it's me. I'm not in denial. I'm coming up out of denial. I'm not going through the blame game. All these are lessons that we've already went over. I'm not going to blame. I'm not blaming the government. I'm not blaming Obama, the left, the right. I'm not blaming my wife. I'm not blaming the pastor. I'm not blaming the program, the cops, the man. Y'all get it, right? I'm not blaming. I'm not blaming the system, my parents, whatever. I'm hanging it up. I'm hanging up the gloves, you know? It's just like always, come on. Some people, you just walk up to them and you just see them like this. You haven't even said anything yet. It's like, what happened? Man, I'm so defensive. What's the problem? You know, I'm hanging up the gloves. I'm putting down my defenses. I'm ready to peel back some stuff. We went over all that, the onion skin lessons and stuff. We realized that I don't just have one problem. I have layers of problems. I have multiple things going on here. I can peel stuff back. Y'all was looking at me like, man, he's got problems. hey, that's why I'm here, all right? Here for a reason. We're ready to peel some stuff back. We've realized that things are not going well. We realize that my life has been controlled by something. There's something, you know, there's a pattern here. There's something, a pattern of complete failure. Drama sticks to me, all these things. These are all results and fruits of a stronghold. We keep coming to the conclusion that I've got something, something's got a stronghold in me, something's deeply rooted inside of me, something's way in there. I know, I'm admitting that there is pain. All right? There's pain. There's pain in there. That's something people have a hard time admitting. You know, that I'm hurt. That's really what we're defending. Nobody likes to hurt. Nobody likes to feel weak. Nobody likes to feel vulnerable. Nobody likes to just be down hurting and crying all the time and feeling hurt. So we try to block that. But we're coming to the point that we say, hey, we know there's pain. We know there's hurt. We know we're admitting that there's unmet needs. There's things in my life that, whether it's right, whether it's wrong, whether it's valid or makes sense or any of that right now, but we're just admitting that it's there. It's there. It might not even be right. I'm not saying cosign whether it's there, but it's there. And it's valid to me. It may not be truth. It may not be real. Once we run it through the courts and all that, and it may not be true, but it's true to me right now where I'm at. And I'm admitting that. I'm admitting I've got some stuff that's true to me. I can't help what you think, but it's true to me. So I'm ready to look at that. We're admitting that. I'm ready to look at these things. I'm ready to let go. I'm ready to let go of some things. Because I've learned, we've learned that powerlessness is actually a place of empowerment. So that's just like totally opposite from everything I ever learned growing up. You know, suck it up, buttercup. You know, be a man, men don't cry. You know, do what you gotta do, hold it together. You know, but we're starting to learn that there is a way. There's a way to drop it. There's a way to tap out. There's a way to surrender. There's a way to be weak. There's a way to be powerlessness. I can say that word all day. But it'd be okay. It'd be acceptable. Why? 2 Corinthians, we went over this. Some of these verses, you know, we went over and over, but these are life verses. These are ones that you need in the briefcase. You need to be able to pull out your little pad, your little speeding ticket pad, and know these verses right here. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Verse 9, and he has said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. For power is perfected in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, I'll rather boast about my weakness, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am well and content with weaknesses, with insults, with distress, with persecutions, with difficulties, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. That just goes against everything we've ever learned. But it's true. And we're starting to learn about this. We're starting to unpack this. We're starting to believe this. So in an act of humility in the kingdom, this act of humility in the kingdom, in the world, that's not something, you don't want to be found weak, you don't want to be found vulnerable, anything like that. But in the kingdom, I've said that before, it's an upside down kingdom. It's an opposite kingdom. It's opposite. The first will be last. All these things, you gotta die to live. You know, all these things are opposite. So when we start thinking kingdom minded, when we start thinking spiritually, we got to realize that it's not what we usually think. It's not the ways of the world. It's not the way that we usually do business. Letting go, it's a good thing. It's a good thing. In order to gain our life, we must lose it. It sounds foolish. This isn't up here, but 1 Corinthians 27. I kind of just wrote this down as an afterthought here that it fits in this category where Paul says, but God has chosen the foolish things. This is another one that we need to have in our memory bank. That God has chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. We got any wise guys? You know? We think we know a little something, right? Well, this is a little warning to us smart people, us intellectual people, us, you know, think we know a little something. No, I'm going to use something really silly. It says, I have chosen the foolish things of the world to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to shame the things which are strong. It's going to be opposite. It's not going to look the way you think it's going to look. Lord's going to do something different. It's going to be opposite. And the base things of the world and the despised things, God has chosen the things that are not so, that he may nullify the things that are, so that no man may boast before God. But by his doing, you are in Christ Jesus. You became to us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. So this is the type of mindset that should start unfolding in this first step right here. Knowing, before we even start stepping into these other things, we need to go in knowing that it's not going to look the way we think it. It's not going to go the way we think it's going to go. It's probably not going to be the way we think it should go. And we should be okay with that. We're not going to run when it doesn't look the way we think it is, when it doesn't feel the way. We're not going to run. We have any runners? Anybody ever run? When the stuff hits the fan, we run. When tragedy happens, we run. We got any ostriches out there? Stick your head in the sand. Oh, God, it's not happening. You know? Of course, we all do that. All right, we're going to start not to do that anymore. We're not going to run. We're not going to hide. We're not going to stick our heads. We're not going to try to fix it. All y'all men want to fix something. Right? Mr. Fix It. Tell me your problems. I will fix you. She don't want you to fix her. Right? Now y'all don't laugh because y'all are always trying to fix something too. We don't have to fix something. We just step back. Step back for a second. You know, we don't have to run. We don't have to do this. All we have to do is trust. That sounds easy, you know, but we need to start practicing. I don't have to fix it. It's not my job to fix it. You know, I don't have to fix it. I don't have to run. I just start practicing to trust. Proverbs 3:5-6. We don't lean on our own understanding anymore. We're going to trust fully in the Lord. We're going to learn to lean on the Lord. Last week, I believe Pastor Dave talked about King Jehoshaphat. And 2 Chronicles, you know, some very good examples of that, of not leaning on your own understanding, not running, but actually pushing straight into the Lord. Let me see if I can go there. 2 Chronicles 20. Second Chronicles chapter 20. I'm going to go with verse 3. I'm not going to read the whole thing because y'all went over it, but verse 3 just sticks out to me. It says, Jehoshaphat was afraid. I got that circle big. Right? He was afraid. Ever been afraid? I don't know how this is going to work. I don't know what's going to happen. But I'm going to admit that I'm powerless. I'm going to be okay doing that because why? Because I know that his grace is sufficient, and that in my weak spot, in my being afraid as he was right here, I know that he's going to rise up. I know something's about to happen. As weak as I feel right now, as scared as I am right now, I know if I just sit back and keep my hands out of it, something good's going to rise out of it. It's verse 3, it says, Jehoshaphat was afraid, and he turned his attention to seek the Lord. He turned his attention to seek the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast throughout all of Judea. He didn't, like I said, I think he drew the triangle. The problem was here. The problem happened. He didn't run. He didn't run and hide. He didn't say, "Let me fix this. I know what to do." He didn't go here. No, he said he was afraid, and he proclaimed, he sought out, he seek the Lord, and rested there. And we know the story, that the Lord did manifest, the Lord did show up in his weakness. He didn't have to take matters in his own hands. He didn't have to panic. All he had to do was seek. Seek what? Seek first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. The kingdom of God and all his righteousness. Seek first. Seek first. Matthew 6:33. Seek first. That's all he had to do. He was dependent. He was dependent on the promises. He was dependent on the promises of the Lord. He rested in them. He trusted in his authority instead of being independent. He could have took matters in his own hands. He did all that. He could have done that. But instead of being independent, he was dependent. Instead of being independent in himself, he was dependent in the Lord. That's what we want to talk about tonight. So I want to start with the definition for independent. I got two of them here. That's what we're going to talk about tonight, our independence. First definition I have is independence is free, being free from outside control. Anybody that don't like people telling them what to do, that probably sounds nice. Being free from outside control. Not depending on another authority. Being free from outside control. Not depending on another authority. Second definition. Not depending on another for livelihood. In other words, I don't need you to survive. I don't need you to live. I'm not depending on another person, another being. I'm not depending on any of that. Not depending on another for livelihood or substance. Some of us in this room know a lot about that. Depending on a substance to survive, to make it through the day. Now, we've been taught and raised that this is a good thing, though. And it is. There's certain examples, there's certain examples that you do need to be independent. You do need to be independent. We've been raised that way and things are, but not when it comes to our relationship with the Lord. Not when it comes, of course, we want to raise our children and our jobs. We want to get to a point that nobody has to hold our hand anymore. We want to become independent in our position. We want our children to grow up and to be independent and carry their own weight in a healthy way. Yes, that's okay. But we're talking about in a spiritual realm here with our relationship with God. That's no good. When we reach that point with God, it's no good. In America, what do we have? We have a whole day for it. We have Independence Day. Right? That's a healthy thing. That's a healthy thing for America, I believe. In America, we have an Independence Day, July 4th. Many people die for that. Right? We stand for that, America, we grab the flags, going up. That's a good thing. Many patriots, I'm trying to restrain from political comments. I got some good ones. Many patriots lost their lives. Right? I can't remember who said this. Somebody help me with this. Give me liberty or give me death. Door prize, please, Butch McNally. Give me liberty or give me death. I mean, that was the declaration. That was the chance. That's how they rolled, right? I think that was a good thing. It was a bold declaration. Okay? Well, as disciples, as men of God, women of God, children of God, we need to also make a bold declaration as disciples, children of God, people taking this first step, starting this journey. This declaration, instead of fighting for our independence, like I said, it needs to be being dependent. dependent on God. In other words, our allegiance, we pledge allegiance to the flag. Well, in this spiritual realm, our allegiance needs to be to the Lamb. I pledge allegiance to the Lamb of God. My allegiance is in Christ. All right? That's the declaration we need to be making as disciples. In the surrender, we're led and we are empowered by the Spirit. And we know what the Word says about the Spirit, where the Spirit of God is, there's what? There's liberty. The very thing that we want, right? The very thing that we want, it's there. It's there, but you just got to do it His way. And we have to be humble enough and open enough to see it. The things that you want are there. The very things. I want freedom. I want this. I want independence. I want to be able to. It's there. But some will you do it my way? Will you take this road? Will you take the high road? Will you pick up your cross? All these things. It's there. Most of us aren't willing to do that at times. That can be hard at times. That can be trying at times. But I'm here to encourage you and tell you that it is there. Now the Lord is the Spirit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Like y'all said. So even though independence may have been good for America, it's not. And good for our kids and taking care of themselves. When it comes to the Lord, we want to be dependent. Because when we are independent, there's a little word for that. A little short little word. There's a sheep back there that talks all about it. What's that little word called? Huh? What was it?
Pride.
Pride. When we start getting that way with the Lord, and we want to be independent and start calling the shots with the Lord, that's nothing less. That's nothing less than pride. This pride, this independent spirit, it's so powerful, it's safe to say it's the root cause of the fall of man. It was then, and it is today. Nothing's changed from the very, very, very beginning. That's kind of what we're going to talk about. Independence, the first sin, from the very beginning, really before the beginning. A lot of people, the fall, Adam and Eve, the fall, the first sin, the fall. Well, no. No, go a little farther. Let's go a little farther than that. I want to go a little farther than that tonight. Sometimes you see somebody, maybe it has been yourself. I know I have. See somebody and go, man, what happened to them? I went to school with them. I did this. We used to play football together. We used to this. We were in high school then. What happened? You got any friends like that? Maybe you are the friend. I've been the what happened guy. What happened to that dude? We see somebody, what happened? Have they always been that way? Have they always, has life been that hard on? Was he always like that? Did they always look like that? Were things always that bad? And most of the time the answer is no. No, it wasn't always like that. So it wasn't always like that. What happened? What happened? So the same with the devil. The same with the enemy. The same with Satan. Right? Yeah. I mean, the word cringes. The devil, Satan, enemy, Lucifer. What? Was he always like that? And the answer is no. No, he wasn't always like that. All right? Actually, the word says he was full of wisdom. Full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. That nasty red pitchfork, nasty, ugly, seven horns, seven head, tail swiping, nasty demon of a guy that we blame everything on. It wasn't always like that. Let's read about that a little bit. Let's go to Ezekiel. Really tonight, what I'm trying to do here is paint a picture of how serious our independence is. Because we cling on to it. And that's really, if you hear anything tonight, I just want you to hear these verses and just know that this is how it all started. This thing that we've been fighting, this thing that we struggle, we all struggle with this. this isn't really about chemical addiction. This is about a war that's going on. This is about a seed that has been planted many, 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 many years ago. Right? Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 13. I think all that's up there. Actually, I'll start in 12. Son of man, take up lamentation over the king Tyre and say to him, thus says the Lord God, you had the seal of perfection. Go back to my question real quick. Was he always like that? Were they always like that? What happened? Because you had the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering. Try to get a visual of this. The ruby, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, the lapis lazuli, turquoise, and the emerald. I don't even know what most of them are. The gold, the workmanship of your settings and sockets was in you. On the day that you were created, they were prepared. You were the anointed cherub who covered and placed you there. You were on the holy mountain of God. You were there, man. You were there. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked in the midst of the stones of the fire. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created and until unrighteousness was found in you. By the abundance of your trade, you were eternally filled with violence and you sinned. Therefore, I have cast you as a profane from the mountain of God, and I have destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of the fire. Your heart was lifted up. There's a cry. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom by reasoning of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I put you before kings that they may see you. That's pretty humiliating. Somebody that was here that just got here. Right? I think we've all been there. I think we've all walked out of the house some days feeling like a hero and come jagging back in feeling like a zero. You know? Anybody ever had a day like that? Right? Sometimes that's preventable, sometimes that's not. In this case, it was very preventable. He allowed the most precious, the head angel, the head leader of music, allowed his beauty, allowed his pride, allowed his position to overtake him. It says, until unrighteousness was found in you. What was this unrighteousness? Because, I mean, this is devastating to the world, to the heavens. It was devastating. So I'd like to know what happened. So maybe, possibly, we cannot have that happen in our life. So let's look at that. Let's look, what was the unrighteousness that was found in you? Let's look in Isaiah. Same storyline here. Talking about the fall of Satan. Isaiah chapter 14. Starting in verse 12. How you have fallen from heaven. How you have fallen from heaven, O star of the morning. Morning star. We know Lucifer, Satan, the evil one, the enemy, all the different names. The heavens knew him as the morning star. What happened? O star of morning, son of dawn, you have been cut down to the earth. You have weakened the nations. Here we go. But you said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I got I will circled. I will raise my throne. I got I will and my throne. What are we hearing there? A bunch of me, all about me, I. I will ascend to the heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. Woo-hoo. Hold on now. And I will sit on the mount of the assembly in the recess of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. Whew. These are heavy words. I will make myself like the Most High. Nevertheless, you will be thrust down to Sheol. I'm going to be like God. Actually, I'm going to surpass God. I'm going to become my own God, and I'm going to become the God. I don't need to be dependent on Him anymore. I'm going to become independent. And we know how that went, right? That didn't go so well. There was a war about that. There was a war. God wasn't going to just politely move off the throne, if you will. So what makes us think that it would go any different for us when we do the same thing? Oh, come on, Lance. That's taking over. Oh, no, we do. We do. We do the same very thing when we enter into this independence, you know. Satan took on this spirit of independence. He was also a patriot. We talked about the patriots of the Lord. Well, Satan took this same position, this spirit of independence, and he was also a patriot that cried out, "Give me liberty or give me death." He was that confident about it. He was that confident in his independence. I'm here to tell you, we're not called to be that confident in our independence at all. We're playing with fire when we start getting to that point. It was out of pride. It was out of selfishness. It was a cry to be independent. Yeah, it sounds good. It sounds noble. But it was a cry to be his own God. It was a cry to be his own God, not dependent on our Lord and Savior at all, but only dependent, independent in himself, only trusting in his own ways, only trying to build his own kingdom. Has anybody ever been there? Can we see, and I know that that's a big extreme. We're talking about the heavenlies right now. But between tonight and next week, I want to try to bring that down and connect the dots of how we do the exact same thing when we take a stand and we say, I'm drawing the line right here. God, I'll let you do this, 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 and this, but you're not going to be the Lord of this part of my life. You're not going to control this. I'll give you this, 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 but I'm taking a stand for my liberty here. I'm taking independence in this area of my life. I'm going to be my own God in this area. You can have it all, but you're not going to have that. We're doing the same thing. And the results are going to be the same. It's going to be a fall. It's going to be a fall. No matter if we're talking about addiction, substance abuse, or just in life, there's going to be a fall because we're not created to operate like that. We are created to be dependent. We are. But in our dependence, he makes us independent in a good, healthy way, in a strong way. That's the beauty of it. You'll still get what you want if you play your cards right. It's called humility. It's still there. That's the beautiful thing. Man, all that energy, and I kind of just did it that way. So as we stop this week, I'm going to go ahead and stop right there. We stop this week, we look, before we handed out list of addictions, I think one of the sheets had strongholds, your list of strongholds. One sheet had the fruit of strongholds. I think some of that's back there on the back table back there. If you don't have any of those sheets and you'd like to get some, if you're interested in some of them, get one of the guys or Jackie. We can get you something if you need to. So I encourage us this week, guys in the program, this is what we're going to journal. Ladies out there, anybody that's out there journaling, I encourage you to journal on this. Take your list of addictions, your list of strongholds, fruits of strongholds, and ask the Lord, say, Lord, what things am I still willing to fight to the death to keep? Lord, what things am I still willing to fight to the death? Give me liberty or give me death. What things in my life, exposed or hidden, whatever it may be, what things in my life am I still willing to fight to the death to keep? Why, Lance? Why are we asking this? Because those are the very thing, that one little thing that you're willing to fight, that's going to be the thing that takes us out. No matter how big or how small. It's all rooted in pride. It's all rooted in independence. It's the first sin that will be the last sin. Amen?
Amen.
Love y'all. Let's have a good week.